Myself Sudeshna Das, faculty of the Department of Media Studies. Today we will deal with the topic ownership patterns in media organization. So the ownership patterns in media organization has been categorized under various categories. So we are discussing the topic ownership patterns in media organization. So the categorization is done in three types accordingly. First, on the basis of operation. Secondly, on the basis of size. And third, on the basis of funding. On the basis of all this categorization in terms of the ownership patterns, the most important one is the on the basis of operation. So under this particular category, we see how the ownership pattern in the media organization functions according to the various media types. So here we have four divisions once again, and the first one being the chain ownership pattern. Second one being the cross-media ownership. Third is the conglomerate ownership. And fourth is the vertical integration. So if we look into the history of the management in terms of the media business, we find that previously during the earlier days, maybe if we take, for example, if we go back in time and take, for example, during the post, just the pre-independence era and immediately after the post-independence era, the concept of management have not set in the media, sector. So at that point of time, it was seen that as we look into the setup of print media, because electronic media was not very popular at that point of time and it has not come in. During the independence era. So if we look into the pattern of the ownership of the print media, that is predominantly in the newspapers and the magazines and the newsletters and so on and so forth, we find that the ownership pattern which was most prevalent was the chain ownership pattern. So what happened at that point of time was that the political leaders of the day, so the people who were wanting to usher in the era of independence in the country, wanted to motivate the people, mobilize the people towards the freedom struggle, they started up with coming up of various kind of newsletters so that they can provoke the people to come and join the freedom struggle. So for that purpose, our political leaders like Mahatma Gandhi, again other social activists like Raja Ramon Rai, they started off with various kind of newspapers. So what they had at that point of time in terms of the ownership pattern was the chain ownership. Now what happens in terms of the chain ownership pattern is that one owner actually ends up owning a series of newspapers or radio stations or televisions, and they confine themselves to a single media type. So if someone is into the newspaper business, they will just propagate their business or try to expand their business by purchasing more and more of other newspapers or coming up with other newspapers and so on and so forth. So they will not go and purchase a television or a radio station. So they will confine themselves to a single media type. Please understand that it is a single media type. So under this, so if we look into the earlier era during the independence and immediately after the independence, when we had the prominent media groups like the Times group and also the Hindustan group and also Ananda Bajar Patrika and so on and so forth, they were only into the ownership of chain of newspapers. They did not engage in the ownership of any other kind of media type. So that is what is meant by the chain ownership pattern. It is not much in prevalence in the present times, because now the times have changed. Electronic media has come as par with the print media. Now chain ownership pattern is not much observed in the present scenario in the media business. So followed by this is what we term as the cross media ownership. So in terms of the cross media ownership, what is happening is that a particular owner does not restrain or does not limit himself by owning only one single media type. Rather, he or she would like to indulge or involve themselves in various kinds of media types. So someone having a newspaper can just go and purchase a television station, can at the same time go and purchase a radio station as well. So they will have stake in various multiple kinds of media type. So that is what is meant by cross media ownership. So cross media ownership is seen very popular in the present times, where all the media barons does not want to confine themselves to owning only one particular media type, but wants to purchase, have a newspaper, have a television, have a radio at the same time. So if you look into the pattern, and this pattern has been much been prevalent in the West. So if you look into the pattern, like if we look into some of the examples, like Rupert Murdoch. So he is a media conglomerate, he is a media baron. So he has the News Corporation Limited under him, and he has stake into various kinds of media type, starting from newspapers to magazines to radio. Even he has assets in cable assets and DTH technology. So they are into this kind of owners, media owners, actually go and have ownership pattern in across various kinds of media type. Now, when we come to the conglomerate ownership, this is another very important ownership pattern which is observed in the present times. The most observed pattern in the present times is between the cross media ownership and the conglomerate ownership. And if you look into the various these two patterns, there is a very thin line which differentiates cross media ownership from conglomerate ownership. So on some occasions, for certain examples, you can see that they are almost interchangeable. They can be seen, the similarities are vast. So in terms of conglomerate ownership, what happens is that the whoever is the owner of that particular media business has two kind of business under him. His primary business is non-media related. So he may be the owner of a textile industry, he may be the owner of a chemical industry, he can be having a steel industry under him. So different kind of non-media related ownership pattern, which is the primary business organization for that particular owner. And at the same time, what he wants to do is he wants to go and purchase a media company as a kind of a subsidiary company for himself along with his primary business concern. So here the motive of that particular media owner is not to gain any kind of a profit or generate a revenue through his media business, because he has a primary business model which is much more worth in terms of revenue generation and profit orientation than the media business. So what he wants basically out of the media business is a kind of a social status. So he wants to have a voice in the society, among the government people, among the policy makers of the day. He wants to have a kind of a social status. He wants to make his presence felt in the society in a big way, so influence the people around him. And that's why he goes and purchases a media company as a subsidiary to his primary business concern, which is much larger in the long run. So in this way, in terms of cross media ownership, conglomerate ownership, this has led to a lot of debates and questions in terms of ethics in the media business, because the different kind of business people are using the various media concerns to meet their own personal ends, and not indulging in the ethics that should be practiced in the media sector. Finally, we come to what is known as the vertical integration. So it is vertical integration is another ownership pattern. So in vertical integration, what happens is, again, this person has, is indulging in a kind of a, owning a kind of a media business. And at the same time, he also, is into the production of the ingredients which is required for that particular primary media business. So here his primary concern, maybe is also a media business. Media, but something related to it. So the ingredients related to it, he is again also producing the same. For example, if someone is owning a newspaper, so what he or she can do, he also has a factory which is processing the ink which is required for for the media, newspaper printing. So if someone is having a kind of a film studio, so they are producing the films. At the same time, they do go and own a series of theaters. They have ownership in the theaters where their films can be displayed. So in this way, the second concern, whichever is there, also keeps on helping the primary media concern which is there. So this is another kind of ownership pattern which is observed in the present times. The second categorization is on the basis of size. So the first categorization talks on the basis of operation, how the media organization is operating under the various ownership pattern. Here on the basis of size, we have again three different kinds. One is big, medium, and small. So on the basis of size, when I say about it, there are two elements which you have to take into account. One is the aspect of revenue, and the other is circulation. So the concept of size is basically decided by the first aspect known as revenue, and the second is the circulation. Now the revenue, when we talk about circulation, we all are talking about generating a profit through the circulation. But in times of newspapers, what happens is newspapers are always sold in a kind of a with a subsidized rate. So if the printing cost of a newspaper is of around 20 to 30 rupees, it is sold at the price of maybe 4 to 5 rupees to the customers. So not much revenue can be generated through the on the basis of circulation for newspapers, but revenue primarily is generated through the method of taking in advertising in the newspaper. So when the advertising clients approach the newspaper on the basis of their circulation figure, the more the circulation, the more will the advertising people flock towards a particular newspaper. So when they approach them, the whatever the revenue is generated through that particular advertising is also decides the size of the newspaper. So on that particular basis, newspapers are divided into big, medium, and small. So the big newspapers is the concept is kind of self-explanatory here, where big newspapers are nothing but the national dailies that we have. In terms of, for example, if you talk about the Times of India, the the Indian Express, the Hindu, so all these are the national dailies and they are the big newspapers. They have lot of circulation figures. Their circulation figures are always high, and the generation of revenue through advertisement is also very appropriate. Now, when you come to the medium newspapers, those are nothing but the regional newspapers that one every region has. So if there is different states, for example, if Karnataka, in terms of Karnataka, we can talk about the Prajavani and so on and so forth as the example for medium newspapers. So when you talk about the small newspapers, those are the local based newspapers. So if there is any newspaper which is functioning only, circulating only within the area of Bangalore, then that can be termed as a small newspaper. So on the basis of size also, the ownership pattern can be divided. And finally, we come on the basis of funding. So funding again can be of two types, that is public and
private funding. So in terms of funding, it is seen that, first of all, if we talk about the public funding, what we are talking about is the government controlled news media organizations. So here, in terms of government controlled news media organizations, we have the examples of Doordarshan and All India Radio. So there, no private stake or ownership is there for that particular newspapers, sorry, for those particular channels and radio stations. So what is happening is the government is providing funding for Doordarshan and All India Radio. Their control over the contents, over the treatment of the programs, over the advertisements, everything is there from the government, and no one else has a stake in the same. So, and the one we talk about the private ownership, we are talking in terms of the businesses which are run by the family, which is run by the stakeholders, by the shareholders, and so on and so forth. So if we look into our media history, in print media also, we can see that how the Kasturi and Sons Limited, or the family of Kasturi and Sons, have been controlling the Hindu for a long period of time. Then Ramoji Rao has the Inadu. So those privately owned and funded, privately funded, where the decision rests with the owners, private owners of the different kind of media organizations. So that, on the basis of that also, the media ownership can be defined. So these are the three various categories on the basis of operation, on the basis of size, and on the basis of funding, that the ownership patterns in media organizations are divided. Now, like I said before, this is the most important ownership pattern. And from that, the conglomerate and the cross media ownership is what which is observed in the present times. So most of the news channels in India, or most of the news media business in India, is also is full of the pattern of the conglomerate ownership. So recently, Reliance has taken over Network 18, CNN IBC, and CNN IBN has come under the under the leadership of the Reliance Group. Reliance Group is mostly into, their primary business is into various kinds of apparel making and textile, and into communication businesses and so on and so forth. So owning a media business is a paltry thing for them in terms of generating a revenue or a profit. But they have tried to purchase, have a majority shares in this particular Network 18, so that they can have a voice and influence over the policymakers, over the government, over their clients, over the other business people whom they have a good relations with. So you can we can see there is there is a corrosion, or we can see that there is a eroding of the concept of ethics in media because of various kinds of ownership pattern. So here, even if we observe for conglomerate ownership pattern, we see that media becomes a kind of a puppet in the hands of certain business people who want to utilize it, or take advantage of it to meet their own business ends. Okay, and in terms of the entire ownership pattern, another thing which is observed is that the idea of making a profit, the concept of what we talk about, basically in electronic media, and also in terms of the television rating points, the run after, or the rat competition after gaining more and more TRP and the having more and more better circulation and viewership figures. So that is what the media has been reduced to in the present time. So sometimes the content of the media, the treatment of the programs, of how news is presented to the people, all of this is under the shadow of under the shadow of this kind of malpractices, or certain concepts which is entirely materialistic in nature and has nothing to do with the ethics in the media business. So people, while engaging in the ownership in various kind of media types, should keep in mind that the end, even though media in the present times have become has converted into an industry like any other sector which are out there, but in terms of becoming a media and entertainment industry, and with the concept of it becoming functioning like an industry, the organizational structure, the people engaging in the media business, the people employed in the media business have a very good future and growth in that particular sector. But in spite of all of that, what we are generating as the content or the programs or the news programs in media has, you know, has deteriorated over the period of time in terms of the ethical concerns which are there. So this needs to be kept in mind when we are talking about the various ownership patterns. Yes, in terms of funding, also we can see the dilemma which is faced by the public funded organizations like All India Radio and Doordarshan. Though they more or less give a very, very bland and impartial kind of a view, again that is very much controlled by the ministry of the day, because they are under the Ministry of Information and Broadcasting. So which is the ministry of the day, and the government controlling at that point of time, which is the government on power, is also the government controlling and using the media like the All India Radio and the Doordarshan as their own mouthpieces. So here also we see that in terms of funding, in terms of the public funding by the government, the media is highly controlled, and where the bureaucrats are running the content in the media and giving the treatment for the programs, which are better left to the experts and the veteran media professionals, which is not being taken into account. So the programming content of both these channels have deteriorated over the period of time, and the popularity has also gone down in comparison to the privately owned channels, which are using more innovative technology and also coming up with various kinds of innovative concepts in their particular programming. Okay, so this is what can be seen in terms of the ownership patterns in the media organization in the present times. There are various good things which are happening in terms of the ownership patterns, in terms of people expanding into opening up more and more media sectors, expanding the media sectors, coming up with various kind of media types, having in India today we have so many newspapers which is not to be which are actually come in the print copy, which is not to be seen in the West, where everything has been converted into the e-version. So the prospects are numerous in the media sector in India today. But when we look into the ownership pattern, the question remains, there should be no monopolization in the aspects of the ownership of media. So no one, the Habs should not be monopolizing the media sector, but everyone should be able to voice their concerns, voice their interest, voice their views, voice their traditions and cultures in the media, and make it portray the diversity which the entire country has. So that is all about this ownership patterns in media organization. Thank you.